Yeah, dear students, time for another medical visualization lecture. This time we want to talk about multimodal medical visualization. That is a timely topic and also clinically very relevant topic. There are various situations where there are several data sets, medical image data sets, necessary for diagnosis or treatment planning. And that, of course, is a motivation to think about how to show these relevant data sets simultaneously so that the user can explore them in an integrated manner and understand the information that is relevant from different source images. I tried to motivate this already with the initial images used here for this title page. For example, here on the left, you see an image that's more than 20 years old, so the topic is not completely new. But that's not so important. More important is you see parts of a CT data set from the head and parts of an MRI data set of the head. And clipping planes are used in order to adjust which portions of the CT and which portions of the MRI data set are visible. You cannot infer too much from one static image, but if you interactively handle this and have the possibility to make continuous changes of the position or orientation of a clipping plane, that helps to get a better understanding of both data sets simultaneously. The combination of CT and MRI is still a bit rare. These are two anatomical imaging modalities. It's more frequent that CT and a functional modality like PET or SPECT are combined. Here in the middle, you see an image that's from dual source CT. So here, the visible information relates to two different energy levels used in the CT acquisition process. Yeah, that is a more recent development, and also this helps to show complementary information on the patient anatomy. The image on the right shows that information is presented that is based on segmentation. So individual structures are shown here, and these are derived from different source data sets. One prerequisite for this is that the data is correctly aligned, that the spatial information really corresponds to each other. Otherwise, the type of overlay would be misleading. Here with the CT and MRI data set, obviously there is a correct overlay of the information, which you see if you look here at the skull. It would be quite obvious if the MRI data set would not be correctly registered to the CT data set, and the outer face would be disturbed. Yeah, so that is an essential prerequisite. We do not want to discuss in this lecture the algorithms that are necessary and important in order to align images, the so-called registration. Instead, we will assume that this process was somehow carried out with sufficient quality so that we can think about how to overlay the information. And already from the initial images like this one here, it becomes clear that maybe the most important problem in multimodal medical visualization is how can we ensure that the essential information is visible. That is already a problem if we only have one data set and we combine opacity transfer functions with clipping planes or other techniques to adjust what should be visible from one data set. But the occlusion problems are, of course, more severe if we have two or even three data sets. So therefore, we will discuss extensively strategies to ensure visibility of the essential information. Yeah, the outline of this lecture. I want to continue a bit with the motivation and describe some major applications. I will describe strategies for multimodal rendering. Multimodal rendering is actually one instance of the more general topic of multi-field volume rendering. Multimodal means that the source images represent different kinds of image data, like CT or PET. Multi-field volume rendering also includes not only this multimodal situation, but also the situation that we have, for example, pre-operative images and intra-operative images, even if they are from the same modality, yeah? Or other more longitudinal images where we have current image data, follow-up image data, later control images from the same patient. And of course, in all these situations, the problem is that we first have to correctly align the data. A number of techniques is based on surface visualization, so we will discuss them. As always, I want to comment a bit on interaction techniques to explore the data. And here one important aspect is transfer function design. We will discuss transfer function design a bit in more detail later, but some special techniques that have been developed for multimodal visualization I want to describe here already. And similarly, illustrative visualization is a topic to be treated later on its own, but here I want to comment some techniques that have been used for multimodal visualization. Yeah. The processes of diagnosis and treatment planning, as well as the follow-up process, that means after some treatment decisions have been carried out and some treatments have been applied to check the state of the patient, whether or not to continue treatment or how to modify treatment, that often requires different data sets. Yeah? And the situation I want to emphasize here, that's why it's shown in bold, is multimodal data, where we have either PET and CT data, or that is a more recent development, PET and MRI data, or just CT and MRI data. Yeah, so that is the focus of this. I would say that multimodal medical visualization is a subfield of medical visualization, also one that was considered as essential quite early. Yeah? Without going into detail, you see here that there are a number of references, and we will see images of these references already in the 1990s. Yeah? And they already developed some nice and appropriate techniques how to explore simultaneously different multimodal data. Further motivating example from Renata Raidu's PhD thesis, where she combines different CT and MRI sequences for the diagnosis of prostate cancer. Yeah? So you are meanwhile a bit familiar with medical image data. Probably you recognize that this is a CT data set. I would say the noise level is quite considerable here. And this is an MRI data set. Yeah? The arrow here points to a region that is probably a tumor. Here is a special sequence of MR imaging, namely diffusion weighted imaging, yeah, where the strength of the diffusion is represented by color, and obviously something is special here. And this is a kind of a time varying data set, DCEMRI, that stands for Dynamic Contrast Enhanced MRI. Actually, with this kind of data, for each voxel you have a time intensity curve. Yeah, so over time, contrast agent is accumulated and then it's washed out, and maybe after a first peak there is a smaller second peak. Yeah, so that is actually the underlying data here. That is not exactly what you see here. What you see here is a static image derived from such curves. So for example, I can take such a time intensity curve for every voxel and say, I'm interested in the area under the curve, which basically tells me how much contrast agent arrives in a certain interval of time. And that is static information I can color code. Yeah? That is how such an image can be generated from these dynamic data. Different information related to the same patient here shown in different images, and the pathology is not even always in the same corner of the data set. So it's quite challenging for a physician to mentally integrate this information. Yeah, there is no overlay supported here by the software, at least not in this specific image. So in the physician's head, this information has to be combined. And that is what we want to support, namely to integrate the interesting portions of both source data. When I say both, I'm maybe a bit more special than absolutely necessary. But from my experience and all my discussions with physicians, I would say it is very unlikely that visualizations are generated with more than two source data. Yeah, in principle, it is possible to overlay CT, MRI, and PET data in one viewer. But then the occlusion problems are really severe and you have to restrict quite strongly what you see from each of the three source images. So I would say in all practical applications now and in the foreseeable future, we typically have two source images. And very often, one of these source images represents functional information, metabolism, for example, in PET data, and the other represents anatomical information. Yeah? So the anatomy is just not visible in MR data, whereas the functional information is not visible in CT or MRI data. So the information represented in the source images is complementary. Yeah? And not in all areas of a PET data set, for example, it is interesting to see the PET data set. The PET data set is primarily acquired to identify regions where the radioactive tracer is uptaken strongly, high uptake regions, and these should be shown along with the anatomy, along with skeletal structures, for example, that serve to understand where in the anatomy is this region with increased uptake. Yeah, one essential aspect is that structures visible in both sources should be shown. So for example, if we have CT and MRI data, it could be quite important to identify the border of the tumor in both data sets. Yeah? They will not perfectly be aligned with each other, even if the data sets are correctly aligned. Yeah, how you assess the border of a tumor may be different in CT and MRI. Probably the true extent is the larger of the two variants. Yeah, so similarities and differences are essential there. So, and if data from different sources are integrated, even with different resolution, for example, that involves some uncertainty that cannot be realized absolutely perfectly. Even in the situation that is currently the best situation that one may have, where we have a hybrid imaging device that acquires simultaneously for the patient CT and PET data, for example, the data is not perfectly aligned. That sounds a bit surprising. Why it is not perfectly aligned? I mean, the patient is on the table. It is only a short amount of time between the two examinations, only a few seconds. So why are there any differences at all? Well, the patient is still alive. He is breathing, for example. So if you want to record this region here, yeah, the thorax region, then of course, due to breathing, you have considerable movements of 1 to 2 centimeters. These movements are even visible and occur with PET CT data, for example, or PET MRI data. Yeah? So therefore, at least in research settings, people try to understand how accurate is this overlay actually, and with this, how reliable is the position that is displayed for a high uptake region, for example. Yeah, to integrate and compare data requires that the data is correctly aligned with each other, and I commented a little bit on this. Let me be a bit more specific. In the situation that we do not have a hybrid imaging device, yeah, that's what I comment here. There are hybrid imaging devices combining PET and CT, PET MRI, And also SPECT CT. I'm not sure whether there is SPECT MRI, but definitely there is SPECT CT. Yeah. When we do not have this fortunate situation, for example, because we want to overlay CT and MRI data, then we must be aware that there are not only movements in between, but these movements are non-rigid. That means it's not sufficient just to try if this is one data set and that is the second data set, how we need to rotate one data set and translate it to come to a correct overlay. But what is a correct overlay is slightly different for the lower left corner of the data set compared to the lower right corner or the top corners or some central parts. Yeah, that is called a non-rigid registration that is necessary. So actually, in these cases, a grid is overlaid to both data sets, and an optimal transformation is computed, typically based on information theoretic measures, how to find a corresponding grid position in the other data set. And with this, some grid cells are a bit distorted, some are stretched, interpolation is carried out. These are all processes that are necessary for achieving a good alignment, but they also lead to a slightly reduced resolution and quality of the data, even if we find a perfect overlay in the sense of an optimization algorithm. Yeah. Another aspect is that we often need to normalize the data with respect to the intensity values. Yeah. And after aligning and normalization, we can fuse them. So that is the essential term that is used to describe the integration of appropriately prepared source images in a multimodal visualization. So I think it's fair to say that multimodal visualization gained a lot of importance and relevance after these hybrid devices were introduced. I think the PET CT scanner was first in 2003, and meanwhile that is really frequently used in hospitals. Yeah. That means there is rarely a PET imaging done with a specialized PET scanner, but it is much more typical that PET data is acquired in a PET CT device and then typically with CT also. Yeah. PET MRI is actually even more promising, yeah, because in particular for tumor diseases, the high soft tissue contrast from MRI is beneficial. However, it was really a challenge to build and construct a PET scanner within the strong magnetic field of an MRI scanner. Yeah, so that took a lot of time. So that is a quite recent development. There are still very few PET MRI scanners, and they are very expensive. Yeah, that means millions of euros are necessary for a PET MRI device. SPECT CT again is cheaper and more widely available. Yeah. So in all these instances, there is one imaging modality from radiology and one from nuclear medicine. So these are two slightly different specialties in medicine. As a consequence of these hybrid scanners, meanwhile, it is typical that within a university hospital, there is one joint department for radiology and nuclear medicine where these devices are located and handled and processed. Yeah. Also in Magdeburg, there is since 12, 14 years a joint department for radiology and nuclear medicine. Yeah, major applications include radiation treatment planning, as we will see, hybrid imaging, as we just discussed. But there is also a bit more, although our focus will be on this hybrid imaging. There's also functional imaging, which is important in the neurosciences, so for basic research, where people want to understand the function of the brain better, different situations where the brain should solve certain tasks. That can be realized with functional imaging data that needs to be combined also with anatomical data of the brain, in order to understand the location of functional regions involved in visual tasks or small computational tasks or other tasks. Yeah. And I already mentioned that another major applications are dual energy CTs, where we have just two energy levels, leading to two different CT data sets, and it's interesting to show simultaneously essential information derived from both of these CT data sets. Yeah, here are two examples, slightly different from radiation treatment planning. So what are the source images that are overlaid here? That's quite interesting. On the one hand, we have the patient anatomy, of course, typically acquired within a planning CT. That means the CT modality is relevant here. And the second major information is the dose distribution after the physicians specified a treatment plan. That means they placed some sources of radioactivity from where radioactive beams are sent in the tissue that should be destroyed. In almost all cases, that is a tumor, mostly a malignant tumor, in some cases also benign tumors. Yeah, it's not only important to understand whether with a certain treatment plan enough radiation actually arrives in the center of the tumor or in the whole tumor, but also that we avoid too much radiation in other tissue, like the eyes, for example, in case that we have a tumor in the brain. The eyes do not tolerate a lot of radiation, and the colon does also not tolerate a lot of radiation. Not a lot means less than 20 grays, for example. Yeah. So this is shown here, color-coded, and needs some exploration techniques so that the user can really understand this. Yeah, we talked already about PET CT data as a major use case for multimodal visualization. Here we see different ways of overlay on the left, and that's still the most frequent way that multimodal visualization in clinical practice is carried out. We see an integrated slice-based viewer. So we have axial slices of the CT data, and as an overlay, we see the PET data. In the middle, we see an oblique view. Yeah, so there it's another slicing direction. And on the right, we see really a direct volume rendering. The source for these images is a paper on the OSIRIX platform. So one thing is interesting here. We see for most parts of the data, the CT data and not the PET data. Yeah, we see the PET data only for some regions. So someone must have made a decision here which portions of the PET data should be shown. And typically this is realized with a threshold that says that PET data is only shown if the activity is above this threshold. And above this threshold, there are of course different values, and we should be able to differentiate them. And therefore a color scale is applied. And this color scale is quite standardized. Yeah. So white really indicates the brightest values, whereas red and orange represents lower values, values above the threshold, but lower than the white values. It's unfortunately not shown here, the color scale. That would be better to interpret the images. But yeah, you can imagine a little bit this color scale. And probably you can also recognize that the same color scale was used here for these different ways of integrating the CT and the PET data. So I would say the CT data is a little bit the background information that's shown everywhere. And if there's something interesting, then the foreground information, namely the PET data, is shown. That is a strategy, by the way, that is quite similar to cartography visualization. In cartography visualization, typically different layers of information may be flexibly combined in an interactive cartography application based on the interest of the user, of course, based on interaction. And there is a base map. Yeah, so the CT data set here corresponds to the base map. And then there is information in these additional layers, which is sparse. That means there the information is not everywhere, but only at selected places. For instance, one layer would be the information related to streets or to railway connections. Yeah, these are then shown on top of the base map. So at these places where this information is available, it actually occludes the base map. But this still makes sense when this only covers a rather small portion of the data. Yeah, here it's a bit hard to estimate for me, but I would suppose that probably 90% of the CT data of that slice is visible, and only 10% is hidden to reveal the PET data. And with this, you have enough information to understand where the where the PET data actually is in relation to the anatomy represented in CT. Yeah, just another example, CT at the one extreme, PET at the other extreme, and then you see intermediate representations where the amount of visible PET information is increased and at the same time the amount of visible CT data is decreased. That's from the same publication. So here it's a series of static images, yeah, and maybe it's not a bad idea to show this. Yeah, an alternative would be to create a small animation, yeah, that fades from CT data to PET data. And maybe it's not necessary to go the whole way. Maybe it could be a subset of a data set where you see a lot of CT and PET is not dominant, to a data set where PET is even more dominant and CT is more fading away. Yeah. So that is this fusion parameter that tells you how important one of the two source images is. Yeah, I said already that dual energy CT is another important use case for multimodal visualization. And here are some examples. Both are from Siemens, by the way, who pioneered this dual energy CT. Yeah, and one more application I want to discuss at least a bit, that is neurosurgery planning based on different information. Actually, a number of modalities can contribute to neurosurgical planning. CT data, because it shows the skeletal structures quite well. MRI data with a better soft tissue contrast, perhaps contrast enhanced data that reveals the vascular structures very well, or even diffusion tensor images that would reveal major white matter tracts, so these are nerve bundles. And a further ingredient for neurosurgery planning could be functional data that show, for example, where the motor cortex of that particular person is and where the visual cortex is. Yeah, that all could be interesting to understand. Can we remove surgically a tumor without destroying major functional areas in the brain or major white matter tracts? Yeah, and if the tumor itself is not in such a critical region, then we can think about what is a good access to the tumor, because we have also to destroy tissue that is not affected by the tumor just to reach the pathology. But there, of course, we have many different ways how to access the tumor. And the planning process is about minimizing the risk that is associated with this access path. As a rule of thumb, of course, typically it is better to use an access path that is short. Yeah. So if I would have a tumor in this part of my brain, it's probably better to have choose an access path from here instead of one from here, where of course I have to remove more tissue. But not always just the shortest Euclidean distance to the tumor is the best choice. So with this background information, I can come to the images that you see here. That is derived from CT data. The tumor was segmented from MRI data, angiography data was also incorporated to segment and finally to display the vascular structures, so that it becomes obvious which vascular structures are in the safety margin around the tumor that we probably need to destroy. Yeah, if these vascular structures are not so large, that is not a severe problem. Bleeding can be stopped intraoperatively quite fast with appropriate methods. If there would be really a large part of the circle of Willis, for example, that would be an argument not to operate the patient. Yeah. Some clipping techniques are used here in order to plan an access path, but also to reveal the pathology and the surrounding structures. Yeah, so here it is a circular region. Yeah, and here different clipping planes are combined to create, yeah, I would say, a wedge that makes the relevant structures visible. Yeah, here in yellow, what you see here are areas that are active when the patient was speaking. Yeah, so that was recorded also to avoid this, that this region would be destroyed. By the way, that is one of the most influential medical visualization papers that I cite here. It's from Johanna Bayer and Katja Bühler, who worked at the VRVIS in Vienna at that time. Katja still working there, Johanna not. Yeah, that's from the same publication, even more data that could be relevant for neurosurgical planning. Here you see the electrodes for epilepsy surgery. Yeah, when patients have severe cases of frequent epilepsy that cannot be treated by drugs sufficiently, then it is an option to apply surgery or deep brain stimulation. These are the alternatives. Yeah, and that serves here to understand where the electrodes need to be placed. Yeah. And that is again an example where we see a tumor, vascular structures, and other surrounding anatomical structures, and that is clearly helpful for neurosurgical planning. So it is based, we must be so honest to say this, on segmentation information. That means you cannot just take the source data, start the system, and then get these nice visualizations, but before you have to carry out these segmentations. And still, segmentation in many cases is not fully automatic, and even if it would be fully automatic and it works, then at least someone has to verify slice by slice whether what was segmented as a tumor, for example, is indeed the true tumor. Yeah, we have already seen one example of DCE MRI data. These are these temporal resolved data, dynamic data. And what happens in such data, where the contrast agent first arrives in one vascular tree, namely the portal vein. The portal vein is a part of the arterial system, and then later it arrives in the liver arteries. Yeah, the second arterial structure supplying the liver with blood. Yeah, that's a speciality of the liver. There are not only arteries and veins, but there are portal veins and hepatic arteries as two arterial structures. Yeah, and here the contrast agent is more in the portal vessels and here in the arterial vessels. And here it's overlaid. Yeah, and that of course is important because for surgery planning, I need not only to understand where is one vascular tree surrounding my tumor, but actually where are all of them. Yeah, so even this is not the full information relevant for surgical planning. We are still missing the hepatic vein that is responsible for the venous drainage of the liver. Yeah, but at least two of the vascular structures are overlaid here. Yeah, we have anatomical data like CT, MRI, and various variants of these techniques. Typically, anatomical data have a rather high spatial resolution. We have functional image data showing functional processes like metabolism. There the resolution is much lower. We may have radiation isodose distribution that can be computed at a very high spatial resolution. We may have segmented data, so I would consider this as a second data set. Yeah? We have on the one hand perhaps a CT data set with the original data. And then we have another volume data set of the same extent with as many voxels as the CT data set. where we know for every voxel to which structure it belongs, yeah, an ID of this structure. And that is another type of input for multimodal visualization. There may be even more data. There are examples where, for example, the distance to a key structure is computed, leading to another volume data set. Yeah? So imagine we have a CT data set and a tumor within it, and then we have a distance volume data set that represents for either for each voxel the distance to this tumor. For all tumor voxels, it's zero, and for all voxels outside the tumor, it has a positive value, indicating how far it is away. Yeah, that could be useful for surgery planning as well, to plan with different safety margins how to remove that tumor. Diffusion tensor data is also part of some multimodal medical visualization systems. Within the different anatomical data, in case that we have more than one of them, there is a rather high information redundancy. So that means that the same information is represented and contrasted in both source data, but shown slightly differently. Yeah? On the other hand, functional and anatomical data do not have a lot in common. Yeah? They are complementary. That is also essential for thinking about the registration process. Information theoretic measures to optimize the overlay of two images can only be applied if there is a considerable overlap of the information in both data sets. If we have complementary information, we would not find information that can be, that is corresponding, that can be really considered as the same information just in another data set. So there are other techniques are necessary. Registration is a process that is could be carried out in two ways. If I have two images A and B, I could register A to B or B to A. And that only needs to be discussed because the result is not exactly the same. And the way that is preferred if we have functional and anatomical data is that we register the functional data to the anatomical data. Yeah, the anatomical data, the base map, and we want to map something on top, so we register it to this base map. Yeah, we may have separated 2D visualizations and integrated 2D visualizations. Separated basically means that we have side-by-side views, as we have already seen. Even there, some support can be provided in order to make the exploration of the data easier. So for example, we could make it possible that when the user places a cursor in one image, that cursor movement is translated to the second image, so that the user is supported in seeing the corresponding parts in the other image, even if it is shown separately. Another way of synchronization is related to scrolling. Yeah, I have CT data on the left, MR or PET data on the right, and I scroll to the CT data, and if I enable it, I scroll simultaneously also to the PET data, so that I always see corresponding slices. That requires, of course, to interpolate slices in the data set that has the lower resolution. As we discussed, that would be the functional data set, the PET data set. Yeah? In the integrated way, we overlay both source data sets. That could be done in such a way that we somehow decide we only want to see pixels from image A, from data set A, if they fulfill a certain condition, they are in a certain interval. Or it could be that we really combine information from two source data semi-transparently, for example. So each of the two source data sets has a certain weight that determines how strongly it is visible in the resulting integrated image. Yeah, and then there are 3D visualization techniques. I said already that 3D visualization of multimodal data primarily has to face occlusion problems. Occlusion problems, as they already occur in single volume rendering, as we discussed earlier, these problems are here even more severe. The tools that we have available in order to control visibility are the same than we have for single volume rendering. We can adjust transfer functions appropriately, and probably if we have more data sets to show, we should adjust transfer functions having the histogram of the data in mind in such a way that the portion of each data set is lower than the portion that we would choose for a single volume rendering. So that is when we want to exploit data properties like intensity values or gradient magnitude or other derived information. The second alternative is to use geometric properties. That means based on where something is in the data set, we decide whether it should be shown or not. Yeah? The simplest variant of using geometric properties to decide what should be visible is to employ a cutting plane, a clipping plane. Yeah? That basically says I have my volume data set and I have one half space that is on the left side of my clipping plane and the other is on the right side, and I define that only one of these two sides should be visible. Another strategy is that we maybe not try to show both volume data sets in their entirety, or at least selections of all portions from the data set, but that we only use one slice from one data set combined with a 3D rendering of the second data set. As a static image, that's not particularly helpful, but if the user can control this one slice by moving a clipping plane, so that in principle arbitrary information even from the data set that's only represented by one slice can be shown, that could be a quite useful technique. Yeah, we will see an example for this as well. Surface rendering means that we extract one surface, typically one surface, from one data set, and the information from the other data set is projected on this reference surface. There are various examples where this has been done. I think the most important relates to the brain. So we have an MRI data set from which we extract the brain, and then we have other data sets where we have measured values within the brain and project them on the outer surface of the brain. And then the question is how these different information should be shown so that the differences are obvious. Well, typically they are color coded. Yeah, so color represents this information that is shown mapped on the brain surface, for example. Yeah, multi-field volume rendering, and here in particular multimodal volume rendering, needs a fusion step. At some point in the volume rendering pipeline, we need to fuse the two or even more source images. What already this early paper from Chai and Zakas from Fraunhofer Darmstadt shows, first in a sketch and then later also with many examples, is that this fusion can be carried out at different stages. Yeah? Here, for example, it is a material fusion, which means that I have my different data sets, maybe compute some properties like the gradient or others, and use this to classify the data. That means to apply a transfer function, because we assume that certain material should be emphasized this way. That is what we are doing to different data sets, and after classification, we have the fusion process and compute a final image. Another variant, that's called shading fusion, is shown here. We fuse later compared to what we see here, namely after classification and the resulting material, we apply shading independently to the information from the different source images, and only after shading we integrate the images. We could even integrate at the very last stage of the pipeline, namely at the pixel level. Yeah. So if we want to compute one pixel of our output image, we compute rays into the scene, we interpolate, apply transfer functions, shading, and so on, and get a value. And we do this for all source images. Let's say for two source images. So we have two values for our pixel, and then we have a function that defines how we combine these two values. An easy way would be to take the average. Yeah. So that is pixel level fusion. Yeah. In different stages of the pipeline, that is the essential point here, fusion can be applied. So here's an example where illumination level fusion was applied, and that is in fact an example where we have such a reference surface, and as I indicated, it's indeed the brain, and we want to map information on top of the brain. Yeah, and here the nice situation is if we fuse the information after shading, this makes it possible to preserve the shape. Yeah, so here is a comparison where the same information from the same data sets is shown. Here with accumulation level fusion, that is earlier, and here with illumination level fusion. And I would argue that the authors are right when saying that the shape of the brain becomes better visible with the right portion. So what type of information is shown here on top of the brain? That's basically the activity seen in PET data. Yeah, and the highest activity encountered for a certain pixel, that defines the color shown on the surface of the brain. Yeah, here's a fusion pipeline for multimodal visualization developed from the colleagues at the VIAVIS in Vienna. Data is fused, and that was primarily motivated by radiation treatment planning. Yeah, we have outlines, we have a binary volume, and we have the dose volume that is computed leading to an ISO dose, and this all is fused together to come up with a result. Yeah, so that is one specific pipeline for multimodal volume rendering. Yeah, data properties that can be used for multi-field rendering. We can apply a so-called fusion transfer function. Yeah, transfer function is typically TF, so now it's an FTF that assigns color and opacity depending on the information from the data sets V1 and V2. It incorporates the intensity and perhaps also the gradient. Yeah, that would mean we want to employ data properties in the fusion process. Geometric properties means that we somehow define what should be removed in terms of a certain geometric shape. That could be a clipping plane, that could be a clipping box, meaning that we have something where we have six clipping planes forming a box. It could also be something that is not based on planar boundaries, but it is curved, yeah, deformable cutting planes. These all would be examples for geometric properties. We could even say we want to show a segmented tumor along with a 1 centimeter safety margin in all direction. That is our essential structure that we want to see, yeah, based on geometric properties. And we show another data set, but we make sure that whenever the other data set would occlude the tumor with the safety margin, we only show the tumor and the safety margin and not the other data set. Yeah, that would be referred by some authors as a smart visibility technique. Yeah, ensuring the visibility of a key structure. And of course, both can be combined. Yeah, a volume rendering where clipping boxes are used, of course, also needs an opacity transfer function, and yeah, both mutually influence each other and finally determine what is visible in the final output image. Yeah, here is another discussion of fusion modes, going back to a group in Spain, where a global fusion transfer function is computed based on many local fusion transfer functions that were defined for individual components. So the hierarchy that you see here, this tree structure, corresponds to the brain and the lobes in the brain. And the colors that you see here obviously correspond to the colors here. And at each level, a transfer function can be defined and is finally integrated as a global transfer function. Yeah? This relates to the same publication. A local transfer function controls the fusion process. It's not such a good idea. Fusion weights are important, so we can again determine to which extent one of the source data sets is visible. Yeah? In principle, that can be done with a variety of data sets, but as I indicated, typically the number of data sets is exactly 2. So, and after all these sketches, you may ask, what is the result of all this? It was applied, as you saw already in the last images, to brain data. PET and MRI data of the brain were the source images that were available, and different combinations could be generated to show regions of interest that are particularly important. Yeah? So the activity is mapped again on the brain surface, as you see here, with red representing very high activity, orange and yellow slightly lower values. Yeah, just some more examples created by combining PET and MR imaging together with MR angiography, which makes sense here, because from MR angiography only the vascular structures are extracted, and the vascular structures represent 1 to 2% of the overall volume. So that is quite sparse information. Yeah, remember the analogy to cartographic maps again, where we have a base map and then combine it with perhaps different layers of sparse information. If the information is indeed sparse, then we can integrate more than 2 data sets. Yeah, and this is to show this idea of representing 1 data set of the source images visually only with a slice. Yeah, so we have a CT data set with a color transfer function that shows the anatomical structures, and the physician takes the ultrasound probe and moves it over the patient, and the information corresponding to the ultrasound probe is overlaid here as just 1 slice. Yeah, and as I mentioned, if the static images would be everything that the user is seeing, that would not help a lot. But if continuously and in real time this can be updated, this really reveals the ultrasound information quite well. And together with the CT data, it may lead to a more comprehensive understanding of the corresponding anatomy. Yeah, transparent overlays we have seen several times. Here are some examples from the Siemens Inside Health magazine, that is a journal where they present their recent developments. In both cases, functional information is visible. On the left, it is SPECT data. With SPECT, slightly different color scales are typically used than for PET data. Yeah. From the same publication, two data sets, and I think in this case that's again PET CT. Yeah, I even included the figure caption that describes in German what happens here. So we have a patient that is 77 years old. The caption describes the kind of treatment that was applied. It is a tumor patient, and he indeed suffered from a recidive. That means the tumor came back after initial treatment. And yeah, different information is described here, what is active, where we have a PET activity, so that probably relates to the new tumor. Yeah, CT data, PET data, and the combined information. I wanted to show some examples, not only from scientific publications, but also from a company to make you aware of the fact that this is really something that is also used in practice and yeah, is also commercially available. Yeah, I make a break as always, because otherwise the lecture takes too long. The last things I wanted to describe in the first part of multimodal rendering is the use of clipping planes. This image you may remember, that was on the initial slide, that is from the same publication. And also the same kind of strategy of overlaying the data. Yeah, we have clipping planes that define what is visible from one data set and also what is visible from the second data set. So none of the two data sets is shown completely. Both of them are restricted by means of clipping planes. Yeah, that's early work from Peter Hastreiter at University of Erlangen of that time. So clipping planes not only are translated through the data, but typically it is important that you can change the angular orientation so that you can rotate them. And the question is a little bit how rotation should be actually carried out. What is it that the user expects? And I tell you what I believe that the user expects. Namely, he expects that he can rotate the clipping plane via its center point, yeah, and not via the center of the data set. Yeah? Typically, if you use your toolkit and insert a clipping plane and apply a rotation handle to it, it would rotate around the center of the data set. Yeah? And a better idea, and that was first described by Jeinek et al. In Tübingen, is to employ instead the center of the clipping plane. Today I have seen several examples where users could manipulate clipping planes, the orientation of clipping planes, and also the center of the rotation with multi-touch gestures. Yeah, that is a good way to accomplish this. Yeah, there are even more advanced techniques related from clipping planes, even clipping planes that may adjust to selected structures. Yeah, they are deformed a bit to completely show or completely hide a structure. There is support for the placement of clipping planes, but still this is somehow advanced and yeah, with hardly reproducible. I mean that if you would give different physicians such tools and ask them to perform diagnosis and treatment planning using an integrated multi-volume renderer with clipping planes to explore the data, probably different physicians would create quite different visualizations and use them for decision support. And if they use quite different visualizations, that leads, of course, to the risk that also the treatment decision itself differs based on what they have seen. So I at least partially agree with the statement that I have read in a paper from Zhang et al. Clinically relevant solutions should not only rely on clipping, yeah, because that's not reproducible enough. Yeah, the final images that I want to show come now, and I would term this as lens-based interaction, or probably the authors also have done this. Here it's stated, a lens can be activated or reset, a magic lens, indeed that is a term frequently used for such kind of interaction. The difference between a real lens and a magic lens is that a real lens enlarges what is seen inside the lens region. Yeah, so that is something that leads perhaps to geometric distortion, but it only has geometric effects. A magic lens may be used to flexibly adapt what is visible in the lens region. Yeah, that is not necessarily about magnification. There could be different information visible. And here the lens is used, I would say, as a window from a foreground data set in a background data set. Yeah? Within the lens region, I see the foreground data set. Outside, I see the background data set. And the lens, of course, can be moved. In this example, it's done quite simply, namely by using sliders. Yeah? So that is how CT and MRI data is combined with lens-based interaction. And here we see this in 2D in the three different slicing directions, axial, coronary, and sagittal images. Here the same strategy is applied to 3D volume rendering with an appropriate opacity transfer function. That is a data set where a patient has an aneurysm, cerebral aneurysm, and that is shown here in CT and MRI data. Yeah, with this I'm ready with the first part of multimodal visualization. I have shown some basic strategies, the overlay in slices and in 3D visualizations defined by transfer functions, so-called fusion transfer functions. Specific control may be possible even with local transfer functions that are applied to certain segment structures. And then finally integrated and combined in one global fusion transfer function. We have also discussed that the fusion of different images can be realized in different stages, yeah, after classification or after illumination or even at the pixel level. With all these techniques, we have assumed that we have correctly registered data where a voxel with the coordinates x, y, and z in one data set really corresponds to a voxel with the same coordinates in the second data set. Yeah? In the next video lecture, we will discuss some more advanced techniques that allow even more fine-grained control of visibility. Thanks for your attention.